Good afternoon, everybody. Great pleasure to welcome Sumaira and Mohana, who have been close supporters of Money Life Foundation ever since we started. And I'm glad it is like that, and I'm glad to see so many activists over here, because I think the way the bill is, it requires people who are affected by it and interested in it to be discussing it rather than just listen to what is happening. Sumaira, as you know, is the founder of Awaaz Foundation, which she set up in 2003 to campaign against noise pollution and environmental protection. For environmental protection. In the context of whistleblowing, Sumaira has played a big role in creating a support movement which provides crucial support to activists. The movement is called Mitra, Movement Against Intimidation, Threat and Revenge Against Activists, to provide support to activists who work in public interest and face threat in the course of their public interest work. She herself, as you know, started it when she was attacked twice during the sand mining inspections that she was conducting, and also has faced nasty litigation and harassment through litigation, which is something that we as journalists face a lot. In fact, the easiest way to shut up a journalist and harass them is to send them a legal notice, because usually it's not about the journalist but the organization that immediately gets scared and backs off and says, I don't want to be in court and I don't want to fight. With these few words, I think we should start the proceedings.
Welcome everyone, and thanks for coming. I feel a little strange about lecturing all of you, because I think many of you know at least as much as I do about this bill and about the background for it. And I think that we should take this as an interactive session. So each slide as we go along, we can discuss. I'll be presenting the first half of this, which is to do with the background to the whistleblowers bill, how it came about and why it is. And Mohana will be presenting the details of what the bill contains. And then we'll have a discussion as to what we should do next. So this is the whistleblowers bill, which was passed on 27th December by the Lok Sabha, and it was passed very recently by the Rajya Sabha without any changes. The bill, there was a need for the bill, which was a felt need of people like us who are activists, who work in the field where we are threatened because of some information that we get or some stands that we take against various illegalities. This is Satyendra Dubey. I think everybody knows him, and he's one of the reasons why the need for the bill suddenly became very prominent, and a lot of people started working for this kind of a bill. There was a lot of outrage. There were thousands of signatures collected. The IITs and IIMs got involved, and this first, the CVC started taking complaints about the bill. The CVC started taking complaints about people who were threatened, and then later on the government, without any discussion at all, went ahead and drafted a bill. So Satyendra Dubey was the first, and then there were all these Enact the Whistleblowers Act, all these demonstrations took place, but many other people were attacked. This is Satish Shetty, and I'll be concentrating on Maharashtra so far as the actual incidents go, because that's the area where all of us work, and this bill is in two parts for us. It's at a national level and a state level. So at the state level, it directly affects us and what has happened to us and what will be happening to us in future. At a national level, we get the framework of what we can do and how to proceed. So this is Satish Shetty, who was attacked in 2010. He was killed when he was out on his morning walk in Pune. And we'll see that a lot of the attacks take place in the areas which are just outside Bombay. There are less attacks in Bombay, although there are more threats in Bombay. And many of the attacks take place in the surrounding areas. And Pune is a very good example. A lot of attacks have taken place in Pune. At the time that he was attacked, there was again a lot of outrage, a lot of citizens groups got together, a lot of people said a lot of things, the media covered it, and the Bombay High Court took up a suo motu PIL to actually protect people, and they asked how they should go about it. They appointed an amicus curiae, and a lot of suggestions were taken what to do. So I'll get to my part or our part in that a little later. But because of Satish Shetty, that move was taken. This is Jay Day. I mean, when we say activists are attacked, I think a lot of activists are attacked, but anybody who exposes an illegality is an activist. And there are a lot of journalists who are doing investigative journalism, and I think journalists of that kind, of which I think Money Life is very much also an investigative journalism model, should also be a part, because they face the same kind of threats and attacks that we do in a slightly different form. Sucheta mentioned that sometimes it's more to do with sending a legal notice and making a journalist shut up. But in its most intense form, it can be murder also, depending on the kind of thing they are opposing. Government officers have also been attacked. This is a government officer from Madhya Pradesh who opposed the illegal stone mining sector, and he was trying to stop these miners who were carrying stones away, and he was crushed to death. And again, there was major outrage, and all these things contributed towards the public outcry, which ultimately led to the whistleblowers bill. So they aren't exempt either. And in Maharashtra, there were other cases of a tehsildar who was attacked at gunpoint when he stopped illegal sand mining at Mahad. I think this was in 2012. So several government officers have been, and of course most recently, although it was not a murder, there was the case of Durga Shakti Nagpal, who was harassed for taking on the illegal sand mining mafia in UP. Maharashtra tops the list of the murders which have taken place. These are people who have been killed, and it's not surprising to me that it should be so, because although we keep talking of lawlessness in other states, actually a lot of the money which is opposing people from taking up public interest causes on the other side is in Maharashtra, and particularly in the areas surrounding Mumbai. So I think in Mumbai we have some amount of protection, because as we can see clearly from the group in this room, most of the activists at least know each other. They may have the same way of working, they may have different viewpoints, they may have whatever, but at least they know of each other, and they know who's working on what, and that, and the media knows them, and that itself provides a support of some kind. So if you look at this list, there's Satish Shetty, who may have been working a lot. In fact, he was working a lot. He collected a lot of data which was potentially very dangerous to people. But at the time he was killed, he was not a famous person. He was not terribly well known to the media. And he was not terribly well known to other activists. So perhaps the people who murdered him felt that they were safe in doing so. It's only later that he became a celebrity, and again because of the media outcry. Again, if you look at Arun Sawant, there are two cases in Thana district. One is of Premnath Jha, which is more recent, and Arun Sawant. These are the outskirts of Bombay, where there is a huge mafia presence, and particularly in the land and the mineral mafias, which make working in those areas very dangerous, and they are less reported in the main city newspapers, and people know a little bit less about the work they do than they do about people who work here. Then there's Aurangabad and Pune three times. Narendra Dabholkar was very well known even before he was murdered, but perhaps the areas that he took on were just so huge and so controversial to a lot of people that they felt that they could go ahead with this. And then we have the last instance, Vilas Bharavkar, who wasn't murdered, but he committed suicide after naming a number of people who were very influential as the people who were against him or who he was working against. So this just shows us the kind of threat that we face, and it also highlights the need that we, more and more, that we should be together, and perhaps that's why we feel slightly safer in Bombay. Not much safer maybe, but a little bit. I was attacked at Mahad. A lot of the work that I have done has been in Mumbai. Some of it has been outside Mumbai. And it's interesting that I was attacked twice, and both times was while I was outside Mumbai, even though I'm known in Mumbai. I think, again, that this is my car after I was attacked. I think a lot of you know the story, so I'm not going to repeat it, but basically I was inspecting a sand mining site, and these people came up, they followed my car, there were three vehicles chasing me, and one vehicle in front which came and bashed up my car and tried to push us over the bridge. If we had been killed, it would have simply been reported as an accident, and the first thing the police did was to file a case against me for rash driving. It was only because there was a journalist with me in the car and that he was able to contact his office and that we got help from the police that we actually got away with it more lightly, and a case was filed against the actual people and not against me. Imagine, I'd have still been fighting that case for rash driving. So this is a small booklet which Awas Foundation published, The Link Between Politicians and Sand Mining in and Around Mumbai. It's very specifically on a topic that I'm working on, which is sand mining. But I think this applies to a lot of the mafias which are around Mumbai, and there is a clear link which can be established on almost every one of these subjects to the mafias and to the politicians. I mean, if you look back on the history and if you actually correlate it, you will find that in every case there is a documented link with politicians. So it's not something which is unknown, it's talked about but not clearly documented in one place, which is why they get away with it and why the police pretend they don't know and the politicians of course pretend that they don't know. Mitra was set up after I was attacked the first time in 2004. I was shocked at that time to find that although a lot of other people had faced threats and are still facing threats, I know, very few people had really talked about it. There was a sense of shame attached to it, that if you've been threatened, then perhaps you yourself are to blame in some manner. Perhaps you've been taking bribes. Perhaps you've been doing something which is a bit dicey yourself. And therefore, people did not talk about the fact that they were threatened. I think when I did start talking about it, a lot of activists expressed that they had been threatened, they had been harassed, some of them had been actually attacked, and there is a need to come together and form some kind of a network, because although, as I said right in the beginning, we may not agree in our styles of functioning, we may not agree in the subjects we work on, we may not agree on many issues, but when it comes to being attacked by somebody who's actually a vested interest we're fighting against, there we should come together. And the person who actually helped us form this name, Mitra, is sitting here, Gaurang Vora, who we were thinking what we should call this network, and he came up with this Mitra, which is Movement Against Intimidation, Threat and Revenge Against Activists. So India's whistleblowers bill is unique in its own way, in spite of all its fault, because it is the only act which recognizes an individual or an NGO as a whistleblower. This means that RTI activists, anti-corruption crusaders and human rights defenders can be potential whistleblowers. So that is one very big thing in our favor, and that's why everybody in this room needs to see how we can really get the impact that we want. In spite of what Mohana said, that it doesn't in its present form cover it in the technical details of it, it does provide that an NGO or an individual can be a whistleblower. So what do we do next? We are all activists here. We need to ensure that the rules which are passed, we said during the course of this that this is only an act and that it will not come into force until it is signed by the president and then notified as rules. So, and the rules are going to be notified by individual state governments. So I think this is a very good opportunity. We are all here. We are all based in one state and one city. We can work out what would work for us, for our state, given the number of attacks and murders which have happened in our state, and come out with a draft set of rules and start putting pressure on the government. We are going to have a new government very shortly. It will only be signed by the president after the new government comes in place, and we have some time to work on it and ensure that we get the rules we want, which cover all these lacunae which Mohana talked about. We need to strengthen the NGO media RTI activists network to protect activists at risk, because that's what is going to protect us ultimately. That's how we do get protected. That's one way. And we need to monitor the use of the Act and the rules. So please support fellow activists under threat. This is to all of you. And we all need to do it together. And we need to discuss it after I finish now and work out our next steps. Maharashtra tops the list, as I said. This is Vilas Bhargavkar. This happened just a few days ago, and it's an example to all of us. This should not happen to us. Let's keep together, let's network properly, and let's work out how we have to do and ensure that it happens. Thank you.